Okay, now.
Registers of ARM. As we have discussed the features of ARM, in the features itself I have clearly mentioned that ARM will be consisting of, or ARM will be coming up with 37 registers. ARM will come up with 37 registers, and all those 37 registers, out of 37 registers, 30 registers are said to be general purpose registers. 30 registers are said to be general purpose registers, and the remaining 7, they are having their individual functionalities. And what are those remaining 7 registers? One is the PC, that is nothing but program counter. And one is the CPSR, where we have seen the CPSR in the microprocessor and the microcontroller also. CPSR is nothing but current program status register. CPSR is nothing but current program status register. And we do have 5 SPSRs. SPSR stands for saved program status registers. So these are all the 37 registers that ARM is coming up with. So what exactly the general purpose registers will do? If we talk about general purpose registers, which we have discussed both in 8051 microcontroller as well as 8086 microprocessor, we could have seen that general purpose registers will be used for the storing of data. They'll be used for the storing of data, and they'll be most widely used other than the other registers like special function registers, indexed and source indexed registers. Other than those registers, general purpose registers are most widely used while you are developing the program for the processor or the controller. But here, the general purpose registers of ARM, they not only store the data, they also store the address. The reason why the general purpose registers of ARM are storing the address means, if you could remember in the beginning or in the features, I could have explained you that ARM will be following von Neumann architecture. ARM will follow von Neumann architecture. There will be two kinds of architectures where every processor or the controller should follow either of those two. The one is the Hardwood and another one is the von Neumann. What is the difference major? There will be many differences, but what is the major difference between those two? In Hardwood, there will be a separate memory, program memory and separate data memory. There will be a separate program memory and data memory. That means whatever the instructions that you are working with, all those instructions will be in program memory, and on what those instructions should work, that data will be in another memory. That we have seen. We have seen 8086 and we have seen 8051. Both of them, they are following Hardwood. Because they the program memory and the data memory both are different. See, program memory and data memory means RAM and ROM only. RAM and ROM only. RAM is nothing but the data memory and ROM is nothing but the program memory. Whatever the processor and the controller that we have discussed till now, they do follow Hardwood. Why I'm saying that means? Because they have separate RAM and ROM. That means for data, there is a separate memory. For programs, there is a separate memory. But the processors are the controllers which follows von Neumann architecture. They do have same memory for both data as well as the program. That means there won't be RAM and ROM. There will be only one memory where within that memory only the programs as well as the data is going to be stored and is going to be accessed by the ARM. So that is the reason why here in ARM, the general purpose registers, they not only deal with the data, they do deal with the address also, because the program is programs are also being saved in the same memory. So address and data both are being carried out by the general purpose registers of ARM. So out of 30 general purpose registers, or simply out of 37 registers, 16 registers are free for the end user. Out of 37 registers, 16 registers are free for the end user. What I meant by this statement, free for the end user, means these 16 registers can be at a time used in your program. It's not that if you are using R1, you should not use R2. If you are using R3, you should not use R4. No such kind of statements. From R0 to R15, that you can see on the screen, from R0 to R15, all these 16 registers can be used at a time in a single program based on your application. It's not mandatory that all the 16 needs to be used. It completely depends on the application for which you are writing your program. But there is a provision that ARM is providing that at a time you can make use of 16 registers. And out of these 16 registers, which are named as R0, R1 and so on, R15, R0 to R12. Register R0 to R12, they are called as general purpose registers. Out of 16 registers which are available for the end user, R0 to R12, that means 13 registers are general purpose registers, and R13, R14 and R15 registers, they are called as special function registers. I'm repeating it once again. There are 16 registers which are available for the user, and out of those 16 registers, R0 to R12 are called as general purpose registers. R0 to R12 are called as general purpose registers. R13, R14 and R15, these three are called as special function registers. These three are called as special function registers. So what is the speciality of those registers, that we will see. Before moving into its functionality, let us see how those registers are named, because they are going to perform some specific operation. So every register, instead of calling it as R13, it will be having separate name based on which, that means by looking at the name of that particular register, we could be able to see, know what is its functionality. So R13 is nothing but the stack pointer, R14 is nothing but the link register, and R15 is nothing but the program counter. R13 is a stack pointer, R14 is a link register, and R15 is a program counter. And what exactly these registers are going to do? See, all these registers, three registers, if you see, all these three registers, R13, R14, R15, first statement related to these three registers is that R13, R14, R15, these three are going to store the address. Be clear with that particular point. R13, R14, R15, as they are special function registers, and they are not going to store the data, they are going to store the address. Address of whom they are going to store, that we will discuss now. So R13, another name for R13 is nothing but stack pointer. So what exactly is stack pointer? Stack pointer is a register which will be storing the top address of the stack. Stack pointer is a register which will be storing the top address of a stack. You might be understand the top address, but what is exactly a stack? Stack is nothing but a temporary storage device within the memory, and that is available only for the processor or the controller. I'm repeating it once again. Stack is a temporary storage space. It is a temporary storage space, and which can be accessed only by the processor or the controller, but not by the end user. What exactly the stack is going to store? Or I mean, I said that it is a temporary storage space. So what is that temporary data that it is storing? See, when we are executing some 20 lines of instructions, you have written a program of 20 lines. But we will be mostly concentrating only on the final result of that program. We don't bother about what could be the output of each and every instruction. But processor needs that information, because if it knows the output of first instruction, based on that only it can perform its operation on its next instruction. That means even though the user do not need the output of each and every instruction, processor needs the output of each and every instruction. So where these intermediate results, that means the output of each and every instruction which is not necessary for the user, are going to be stored, they are all going to be stored in a space called stack. So stack will be containing the outputs of each and every instruction, or in a single statement we can say that stack will be storing the previous data. Stack will store the previous data. That means if processor is executing instruction number 2, then it will be storing the output of instruction number 1. So in a simple way, in a single statement, we can state that stack is a temporary storage space which stores the previous data and which can be accessed only by the processor or the controller. is stack and the address of, that means the top of that particular stack, the top of that particular stack can be stored in stack pointer. That means from where the stack is going to be stored, that address is going to be stored in stack pointer. So stack pointer is nothing but the R13 register. And what is the next one? R14 register. R14 means link register. So what is this link register is? It's very simple. We have seen the programs related to 8051 as well as related to 8086. Whenever we are writing a program, we have seen the branch instructions. Branch instructions means call, jump, conditional instructions, jump if zero, jump if non-zero. That means whenever processor come to that particular jump if zero, then it will be processor will wait until that particular condition is going to be true or not. That means the what we call execution will not be in a step by step manner. So whenever the processor is executing some third instruction, and after the third instruction it has to move on to fourth instruction, but in between third and fourth instructions, if you are making use of a jump instruction, which we generally call it as a branch instruction, then whatever that jump instruction says, that needs to be executed by the processor instead of going to the fourth instruction. So when it is going to execute that jump instruction, after the execution of that jump instruction, it should come back. It should come back to its original position and it start executing that. So when it is going to execute the sub program or sub routine, in this example I have taken the jump instruction, right? So whenever it is going to execute that jump instruction, there should be someone who should store the address, the written address from where the processor has to execute once after coming back. Let me simplify you with a simple real-time example. Say for example, when I'm delivering a lecture, I have prepared a slides of 6 to 7 slides. I have prepared a 6 to 7 slides to deliver the lecture in 1 hour time. And I have explained the second slide. Okay, I explained the second slide and next I have to move on to the third slide. Next I have to go on to third slide. So while I'm moving on to the third slide, I just got a call from my higher authority. Then what should I do? I should stop delivering the lecture and I should attend the call. That means I have to give my service to the call. So after the discussion is over, let us say that 5 to 10 minutes of discussion has happened with my higher authority, and that means discussion is happening means I'm serving them. I'm executing the instruction that I got. What is the instruction that I got? Picking up the call from higher authority. That is the instruction. So I have done that. I completed that. I have discussed and I disconnected my call. Now I should come back. I should come back. So while I'm coming back, I should know where I have stopped. As a human being, as I have a brain, I'll be knowing that I stopped at slide 2. So I need to start from slide 2, or else I stopped at slide 2. I have discussed this slide 2. I should move on to slide 3. As I have a brain, as I am a human being, I can know where I stopped. But how can the processor will come to know? It is in the process of executing set of instructions, and in between that it got an interrupt, or it got a subroutine. It went to execute that subroutine. So how the processor will come to know the next instruction? What should be the next instruction that it has to execute after completing the subroutine? That address, that written address of the processor, I mean of the instruction that is to be executed by the processor after serving the subroutine, is being stored in link register. So in a single statement, link register will store the written address whenever there is a subroutine. Link register will store the written address whenever there is a subroutine. This is what about the R14 register and R15. R15 is nothing but the program counter, which you have seen for 8051. 8051 is also having program counter, and 8086, instead of calling program counter, there we have instruction pointer. So the functioning of either the instruction pointer or the program counter is same. That is nothing but they'll be storing the address of the next instruction to be executed. They'll be storing address of the next instruction to be executed. See, don't be confused with link register and program counter. What program counter will do is that if process program counter will store the address of 8th instruction. And when it is executing 8, program counter will store the address of 9th instruction. Program counter, whatever the program counter stores, that address will be in a sequential order. But link register, it will not do. It will store the written address when processor went somewhere to give its service. And in that scenario, link register will store the written address so that it would be helpful for the processor to continue its operation. So there is a clear-cut difference between the link register and program counter. Link register will store the written address, but program counter will store the address of the next instruction. So this is about the registers that are being available in the ARM processor. And here I have written CPSR. CPSR is nothing but the current program status register. So why is it used? For what purpose CPSR is there? See, current program status register, as I have discussed in the features, ARM will be operating in 7 modes. ARM will operate in 7 modes. So CPSR will decide in which mode, or CPSR will give us an information that in which mode currently the ARM is operating. So the mode of operation of ARM, mode of operation of ARM is being explained by the CPSR. As all the registers of ARM are of 32-bit registers, CPSR is also of 32-bit register. And all these 32 bits, they have been segregated into 4 fields. All the 32 bits of CPSR, they have been segregated into 4 groups. And under each group, I mean, that means each group will be containing 8 bits. See here in the diagram, you can see from 0 to 31, there will be totally 32 bits. And all those 32 bits have been divided into 4 parts. And each part has given some naming. So bit number 0 to bit number 7, they are called as controlling bits. And next 8 bits are called as extension bits. Further 8 bits are called as status bits. And last 8 bits are called as flag bits. That means the CPSR operation is divided into 4 fields: controlling bits, extension bits, status bits, and flag bits. So out of all these 4 folds, the extension and the status, here it was written blank. What does that indicate? That by the time ARM is being developed, the extension and the status bits, they have been left for the future purpose. That means they are not meant for any other operation by the time ARM is into the market. So this extension and the status bits, they are not in use by the time it was introduced. And the main concentration will be on control bits and the flag bits. So here flag bits, here ARM will be having 4 flags. You can see N, Z, C, V. So these 4 are the flags that will be available for the ARM. So N is nothing but negative flag, zero flag, carry flag, overflow flag. Negative flag, zero flag, carry flag, overflow flag. We have discussed about these flags when they are going to set in 8051. The operation is same here also. Zero flag. So when the operation, if the result is zero, then zero flag is going to set. Carry flag, if the result contains carry, if the result is carrying carry, then the carry flag is going to set. Negative, if the MSB bit, if the result MSB bit of your result is 1, if the MSB bit of your result is 1, that indicates that it's a negative number, then in those scenarios, negative flag is going to be set. Overflow flag. Overflow means every processor will work with bits. That means to say, say for example, 8086, it will be working with 16 bits. 8051, it will be working with 8 bits. And this ARM will be working with 32 bits. So if you are giving more than that, and if the ARM is executing the wrong, even though you have given 34 bits, it will be executing by considering 32 bits only. That means if overflow is occurring, that means there will be some value. The result should fall in between a lower cutoff to the higher cutoff values. So if your result is not within the threshold values, then in those scenarios, the overflow flag is going to be set. So that is about the flags. And moving to the first part, that is nothing but the controlling bits. So these are very, very important bits. And in this, bit number 0 to bit number 4, they will decide in which mode. That means not deciding the values that lies between 0 to 4. They gives us an information that in which mode ARM processor is in. And if you look at bit number 5, it is given as T. So here, one important point is that ARM will be operating in two states. One is the not operating. We can say that it has two states. One is the thumb state, another one is the ARM state. One is thumb state and another one is ARM state. So if T is equals to 1, if T is equals to 1, then ARM is said to be in thumb state. And if T is equals to 1, then processor is said to be in ARM state. Okay, and next, I and F, they are nothing but the interrupt masks. They are nothing but the interrupts. That means based on the value that here it is having fast interrupt and a normal interrupt. So if F is equals to 1, that indicates that it's a fast interrupt. That means that interrupt needs to be executed very fastly. If I is equals to 1, that indicates that it's a normal interrupt which can be executed. That means the decision of executing the normal interrupt, that can be decided by the processor. In a simple way, this bit number 6 and bit number 7, they'll be giving us an information of whether the interrupt is a maskable interrupt or whether it is a non-maskable interrupt. And now this is about the CPSR, and we will see the modes, the values. What could be the mode if the values are being changed? Say this. So this is the, as I told you, the first four bits. That means D0, D1, D2. First four only. 0, 1, 2, 3, 4. That means totally 5 bits. The 5 bits of CPSR will decide the mode of operation. D0 to D4. See here. 1, 4 zeros. If this is the value, then the processor is said to be in abort mode. Now, after the completion of this table, I'll be explaining all these modes. Don't worry about it. So this is the tabular column. So based on the values that we can see here, the mode of the processor can be decided. Abort mode, supervisor mode, user defined, interrupt, fast interrupt, undefined, and system. So these are all the 7 modes in which the processor can execute, and how to know in which mode it is operating, that depends upon the first 5 bits of the CPSR. So these are all the values. Okay, and now I'm moving on to the modes. Just now I have told you that ARM will be operating in 7 modes, and what exactly these modes will, I mean, how these modes gives, what kind of information that they give us. See, modes will say us that which registers are active and what kind of registers, I mean, what kind of accessibility that we have for the CPSR. That means I'm saying that 16 registers are at a time available for the user. Out of all the 16 registers, based on the mode, there will be some active registers and deactive registers. So which registers are active, that information will be provided by the modes. And another one is whether the processor can completely access the CPSR or not. Processor completely access the CPSR or not. What does I mean to say is, accessing CPSR means, can processor only read CPSR, or whether it can also write to the CPSR. Reading and writing operation of CPSR, to what extent processor can read and to what extent the processor can write, that information will also be provided by the modes of the ARM. And basically all these 7 modes, they have been categorized into 2 types. One is the privileged mode and another one is the non-privileged mode. The 7 modes of ARM, they are categorized into 2 types. One is the privileged mode and another one is the non-privileged mode. So out of 7 modes, only one mode will come under non-privileged mode. Only one mode will come under non-privileged mode. Before moving on to that, let me tell you what is this privileged mode and non-privileged mode. Privileged mode means when processor is in privileged mode, then that indicates that processor can read the CPSR as well as it can write the CPSR. That means both reading and writing can be done by the processor to or from the CPSR. And if it is in non-privileged mode, if processor is a non-privileged mode, it can just read the data whatever is present in CPSR. It cannot write anything to the CPSR. That is the definitions of privileged or non-privileged. Privileged modes gives the access to the processor in such a way that processor can read and processor can write CPSR. It can read from the CPSR or it can write to the CPSR. And if the processor is in non-privileged mode, then it is having only one accessibility. That is nothing but it can read the data from the CPSR, but it cannot write. So out of these seven, what we call modes, only one mode is the non-privileged mode. Only one is the non-privileged mode, and all the remaining six are privileged modes only. So what is that non-privileged mode? User mode. User mode is nothing but the non-privileged mode. User mode is nothing but the non-privileged mode. That means, see, we are the users. Whenever we are working with something called computer, whatever it is coming up with the features, we can do anything with those features. But we cannot say, for example, I'm saying that ARM that is available is of 32-bit. You can do whatever you want to do with 32-bit. You can read the 32-bit. You can do some operations with the 32-bit. But can you, on your own, make that 32 bits as a 34 bits until and unless you become what we call good in this? It's not possible. User mode means whatever is available with a device that can be used by the user. That means he can read it. He cannot modify the features of that device until and unless he is a technical person. So in that way also you can remember, or simply you can remember that user mode is a non-privileged mode. And now let us see what exactly these modes. Abort mode. So when processor will be in abort mode. So whenever processor is trying to access the memory, if it fails, and if it is failing, that means if processor is not able to access the memory, then at that time processor will be moving on to abort mode. Abort means processor is not able to access the memory. And next is fast interrupt request. I told you that there will be maskable and non-maskable interrupts. That maskable interrupt means processor can take the decision whether they needs to be executed or not. But non-maskable means they have to be executed. So here fast interrupt request means whenever the high priority interrupt means non-maskable interrupt. Whenever high priority interrupt or non-maskable interrupt is coming to the processor, then the processor will move on to this FIQ and it will serve that high priority interrupt and it will come back. Interrupt request means whenever a maskable interrupts or the low priority interrupts are coming to it, then processor will move on to IRQ. So there, whenever if the interrupt is of lower priority and or in another way, if those interrupts can be maskable, then it is not mandatory that processor should survive those interrupts at that time itself. They can serve them at the when processor is free. And next is nothing but the supervisor mode. So every processor or the controller which follows ARM, they by defaultly in supervisor mode only. So when does the processor will move on to supervisor means whenever you reset your processor, immediately it will be moving on to the supervisor mode. The mode that processor will be there soon after you reset your system is nothing but the supervisor mode. And next is nothing but the system mode. It is nothing but a special version of the user mode only. System mode is nothing but special version of the user mode. And undefined mode. What is this undefined mode? When processor will move on to undefined mode? Whenever it is executing an instruction and if it finds that that instruction is not defined properly. Not defined properly means, see here, in order to write move AX, BX, in our language, move spelling is MOVE. But in assembly language, we have to write it as MOV. So by mistakenly, after V, if you are introducing E, then that is an undefined instruction for the processor, because it can understand only MOV. It cannot understand MOVE. So when there are such kind of instructions, that means if the instructions are not defined properly, then processor will move on to the undefined mode. Then processor will move on to undefined mode. What is the user mode? User mode is nothing but, whenever the end user is writing some programs for the applications, then the processor will be moving on to the, then processor is set to be user mode. That means if that particular ARM is giving some provision for the end user to write some programs for it, then it is said to be in user mode. And this user mode is the non-privileged mode, and all these modes are privileged modes only. So that means whenever the processor is in these six modes, it can read the data from CPSR and it can write the data to the CPSR. But whenever the processor is in user mode, then it can just read the CPSR. It cannot do any writing operation for the CPSR. See here, these are the processor modes and bankcode registers. Nothing to worry. We have discussed the registers separately and we have discussed the modes separately. So now I'm just combining. See here. So whenever, based on the mode in which ARM processor is there, the active registers will be varying. See, what are the active registers in each and every mode? So if ARM is in user and system, here we are combining the user and system. So when it is in these two modes, when it is in user mode and when it is in system mode, all these registers can be available. That means all these registers will be activated. Okay, and whenever the processor is in FIR, then only these registers are active. Only these registers. See, the naming is changing. Here it is simply R8, but here it is R8 FIQ. FIQ means fast interrupt request. R9 FIQ, R10 FIQ. So when it is moving on to the interrupt request mode, then R13 and R14 will be changing and remaining will be same. See here, in user and system mode, all the 16 registers will be active. And when it is shifting to fast interrupt request, up to R7, they will be as it is available. But from R8, they are not available as it is. They are available in this particular naming. And in a similar way, see here there is a difference between these two also. In this user and system mode, CPSR is available. But SPSR is not available. But if you see the remaining all the modes, in remaining all the modes, CPSR is not available. SPSR is available with the name changing. Here it is available as SPSR fast interrupt request, SPSR interrupt request, SPSR supervisory mode, SPSR undefined mode, SPSR ABT mode. So that means here till R7, they are saying from R18 to R14, the naming will be changing. And in a similar way here, R13 and R14 naming will be changed. So from here, interrupt request to till the abort mode, the naming is going to change for the R13 and R14. And SPSR is not available for user and system modes, and CPSR is not available for the rest of the modes. So this is about the ARM processor modes and the bankcode registers. So here, I told you, right, the privilege and the abbreviations and the mode bit that was simply tabulated. Abort means its abbreviation is nothing but ABT, and abort is a privileged. I told you that only the user is the non-privileged mode. And remaining all are privileged modes and their values. Values in the sense, in CPSR, we have seen that the first five bits, 0 to 4, these 5 bits, the values of these 5 bits will decide as the name of the mode. So that is what written here. And next, moving on to the concept of pipelining. So initially, when the ARM was introduced, the basic ARM, now we have ARM 9, ARM 11, like that we are having so many advancements in ARM. But usually, whenever the ARM is introduced for the first time, it is coming, it has come up with three-stage pipelining. Before moving on to stages, I hope you all know what is the pipelining means. Pipelining is nothing but when one instruction is in execution, the processor will not wait for the completion of its execution. It will be fetching the next instruction which is to be executed. That means at a time, 2 to 3 operations will be running at the back end. That is nothing but the pipelining. So what is the use of this pipelining? See, before the means when one instruction is in execution and if the next instruction is fetched and if it is readily kept for the processor, then the searching time of the next instruction will be reduced. If the searching time is reduced, then execution speed will be more. That's what we require, right? Whenever we type something, that should be immediately displayed on the screen. And if we can see any time while, that means whenever you are typing A, after 2 seconds or 3 seconds, if you are able to see that on the screen, will be irritated. That means the execution time of your processor is said to be less. So pipelining will increase the execution time. It will increase the execution speed of the processor or the controller. And initially, ARM will be coming up with three-stage pipelining. What are those three stages? Fetching the instruction, decoding the instruction, and executing the instruction. So what will happen in first stage? In fetch stage, when processor is in fetch stage, it will load the instruction. When it is in fetch stage, it load the instruction. And when it is in decode stage, I told you that all the instructions needs to be decoded before they move on to the execution, because everything will be in assembly language and everything needs to be converted into binary language and that needs to be decoded. So all those things will be done in the decoding stage, and in the final stage, in execution stage, those decoded instruction will be processed and the result will be stored in a register. So initially, ARM will be coming up with three-stage pipelining, and this three-stage pipelining is now being followed by ARM7 also. I told you that after the invention of ARM, there is a wide change in the world. Many devices have become automatic, and everything is because of this introduction of ARM only. We have ARM7, ARM9, 10, 11, like that. Still there are advancements. So initially it has come up with ARM7, and ARM7 will be supporting the three-stage pipelining. See here, how this three-stage pipelining will work, that I tried to keep it in a pictorial format. See here, in its first cycle, and one more thing is that here each and every instruction will be executed in one cycle. Each and every instruction is being executed in one cycle. So in first cycle, processor has got its first instruction, and here my first instruction is an add. And in the second cycle, the first instruction moved to the next stage. What is the next stage of fetch? Next stage of fetch is decode. That means now the fetch stage is empty because the instruction has been moved on to the decode. So instead of keeping this fetch stage empty, processor has taken its next instruction. My first instruction is here. And in cycle 2, my first instruction moved to the next stage. So in cycle 2, processor has fetched the next instruction. And in cycle 3, where the first instruction is? In cycle 3, first instruction has been moved on to execution state. And the second instruction has been moved on to decode stage. And the fetch stage is having the next instruction. That is how, see here. Here within 3 cycles, out of 3 instructions, one instruction is in execution mode. That means within a single cycle, there is a chance that, I mean, there is, without wasting a time, before to the concept of pipelining, what happens, you know, until unless this add instruction is executed here, these two fields are said to be empty. That means until the completion of the execution of the first instruction, there is no chance to get the next instruction before the concept of pipelining. But after the invention of the pipelining, the processor speed has been increased in this way because the processor knows the next instruction. Yes, it is executing add. After executing add, what it should execute, that it knows, because the next instruction is ready in the decoding stage. And after the second instruction, what it has to execute, it is readily available in fetch. So here processor no need to search for its next instruction. Everything is readily available because of the pipelining. So this is what about the pipelining concept. ARM 7 or the initial ARM is coming up with three stage, and the pipelining stages can be increased. Whatever this pipelining diagram that you are seeing here, see here, it is the ARM 9 pipelining stage, and it is five stage pipelining. ARM 9 is having five stages, and similarly if you observe ARM 10, it is having six stages. That, as I told you, based on the advancement, the pipelining stages are increasing and the processor speed, the execution speed is also being increased. So this is what all about the register set, the operating modes, and the pipelining of the ARM. Guys, are you all clear with this?
Yes, ma'am.